So hi everyone, and thanks for welcoming here. Well, the first ruler I focused on during my PhD was Kujula Katfaisis, the founder of the Kushan Empire in the middle of the first century AD. And today I will talk about one of his most debated coin typology, known as the Roman Emperor type, as you can see, for example, in the catalog of the American Numismatic Society or in the hopefully forthcoming catalog of Joe and Robert. And I want to talk about this coin because I wasn't completely sold on the idea that it was only a mere copy of a Roman coin. And in order to better understand this typology, I wanted to take a look at the context in which it was mainly found, the city of Taxila. And okay, it works. Taking a look at the map on the screen, we can see where the Kushan Empire was roughly located in Central Asia, stretching from nowadays Uzbekistan and Tajikistan to northwestern India. And the red circle shows the location of Taxila, reached by Kujula in the last year of his rule, after an eastward expansion started from Bactria, and passing via the Hindu Kush range, and after a stop in the city of Bagram. During his expansion, Kujula issued different coin typologies imitating the previous coinage and the previous authorities, entering in this sort of legitimizing continuity with these authorities, and adopting only small features in order to distinguish himself. Now I want to show you some examples. Now we see a rare silver obol found in Bactria, and Kujula, whose name is on the reverse, imitates the silver obol of Eucratides, the great ruler of the Greco-Bactrian kingdom. And for example, after crossing the Hindu Kush at Bagram, Kujula issued copper coins in imitation of the previous, most probably Sidian authority, at its turn imitating the coins of Hermeus, one of the last Indo-Greek rulers of Paropamisadi and Arachosia. And once you reach the Taxila, probably now I should just put this one here. After reaching Taxila, Kujula issued this particular particular coin depicting the sitting ruler in this cross-legged position and holding a pickaxe with his right hand. And a coin strongly recalling the previous coinage of Edzis II, pretty much in the same position. And but when he issues the Roman Emperor type, it was the first time that he chose a foreign iconography. Why did he do something like that here? Let's see the coin in detail in order to hopefully understand why. The obverse depicts the head of a Roman emperor of the Julio-Claudian dynasty. During their age, during the Julio-Claudian age, thousands of Roman coins reached India through the international markets. And therefore, it is reasonable to think that where the engravers of Kujula took inspiration from. But there's more. Let's look at the reverse. It depicts a seated figure, probably the king himself, dressed in Central Asian clothes. We can see the trousers. Here is not completely understandable, but it wears, should wear a jacket, and he wears a pointed cap. He holds a turquoise with his right hand stretched, and he holds a sword at the left of his waist, and he sits on what resembles a curul chair, and it is easy to find in modern historiography that the coin is a mere imitation of Roman models. But I think instead that the reverse consciously reflects the local context of Taxila and Gandhara, and the Roman design is only the starting point from which Kujula applied some modification to distinguish himself and send a new message, as you can see, for example, in the inscriptions. Now, for example, in the obverse, we can see the name of the ruler, Kujula Kadafes, the name of the family, the caution, Su, Zau, titles, referring to him as the king, as the tribal ruler, and the same titles are applied on the reverse, but the reverse adds this particular epithet, which is Sacha Dramatidasa, which means steadfast, solid in the true law. And I think that the answer to these questions, to why he applies this particular modification, can be found in Taxila. Let's see now. The importance of Taxila stretches back to the time of Alexander the Great, who took control of the city after the defeat of the Achaemenids. And but after the scattering of his empire in Central Asia, the Mauryans took control of the city and maintained its control for more than one century. And their demise at the beginning of the second century before Christ allowed the city to gain some kind of independence, becoming a sort of independent city-state, strongly influenced by the trade guilds, which are corporations of merchants, traders, artisans, as can be attested, as can be seen, thanks to the, you can see the coins on the above on the right on the screen, coins issued by these local trade guilds. And but after their independent rule on the city, the arrival of the Greco-Bactrians and the Indo-Greek gave them control of the city, which passed under the Indo-Sidian control in the middle, or slightly in the middle of the first century before Christ, and lasted until the arrival of Kujula, probably at the end of the first century after Christ. Therefore, the is a city strongly contended, especially for its important position along the so-called Uttarapatha, which is the northern road, if you should see it on the screen, leading from Bactria to India, and which interconnected different realities and allowed a great flow of people, merchants, monks, and goods. And among these goods, merchants were aware of the importance of Roman coins, thousands of which were found in India. And Kujula's engravers took probably inspiration from them. And I think, not surprisingly, that they took inspiration from the most attested one, which is this denarius of Tiberius, amounting to more than 3,000 specimens in India. And during a period of a great debasement of precious metal in the coinage of Gandhara, recalling one of the most known coin in the market could be interpreted as a guarantee by merchants, and that could legitimize on the markets the coin of Cujul. I mean, this is my hypothesis. And moreover, we find in Taxila, we find in Taxila a Roman coin in the Buddhist context. And as you can see, a coin which is very, very similar to the most attested one in India. That is not, I know that there is not a proof, but I think that it means definitely something compared to the absence of Roman coin in the in what was the Kushan Empire, the Kushan Kingdom. And I think that, the religious connection is probably hidden by the bar. So I think that this interference of merchants in the Buddhist context should not be too surprising. Also in the light of the importance of Buddhism in Taxila, I brought you some examples from the architecture, from some statues. Below there is the Taxila silver scroll. And Taxila, Buddhism was important in Taxila as already shown by literature. For example, we find examples of Taxila mentioned in the Jatakas, the previous lives of the Buddha. And by the great archaeological change under Kujula, especially the temples, as shown by the coin deposits, which attest the presence of the ruler in particular context. Also, the rapid spread of small stupas, the building reliquaries, around larger ones may let reasonably infer that the great interest of merchants, that merchants had great interest in their spiritual salvation. But I mean, the question is steadfast in what law? Since now, until now, I talked about Buddhism, but in Taxila, as you can see on the left of the screen, are also attested examples of other cults. And here you can see the so-called Jandial Sea Temple, recently revised in an article by Claude Rapin, and showing an early form of Vishnuism, strongly flanked by the attributes of Heracles, according to the archaeological remains in the temple. And all in all, Kujula be therefore steadfast in an ambiguous law, meeting both Buddhism and Hinduism, but we are aware that the former was strongly linked with the merchants. And in the end, I wanted to take a look at the models from which Kujula may have taken inspiration. As I told you, the design is copied from a Roman coin, but Kujula applied some modification in order to have his coin recognized by his local subject. And I wanted to start from the Kurul chair and bring to you another interpretation recently stated, hypothesized by Fabrizio Sinisi, in which the Kurul chair found in Taxila, as you can see on the screen, may also be a diphros, a folding stool known in the Gandharan area, and we can also see on this embroidery from Mongolia at Noinula. And the same folding stool, which is depicted in, now I couldn't find a better example, I'm sorry about that, but should be depicted in this imitation coin find in Accra, in the Bannu region, during the age of Kujula, which is an imitation of a local coin of Aziz II, depicting this goddess sitting on a throne, holding a cornucopia, and stretching a right hand, holding a turquoise in the hand. The same turquoise, which can be found in this specimen from Taxila, issued during the age of Mawes. As you, if you remember, also Kujula in his coin holds a turquoise in his hand. And also in this specimen of the British Museum, also found in the Bannu region, in imitation of Hermaeus during the age of Kujula. So that's it. I hope I just wanted to thank you for the attention, and also for welcoming me in Oxford and allowing me to speak with you about my first love in the research of the Kushan Empire. And now here we find some the coin sources from where I took the images, and then also I'm not very good with Zoom, and the bibliography on religion and Buddhism, on the economy and coinage, and also on the Roman emperor type, and on Taxila. Thank you very much.